Welcome to the breakout session on health and basic discovery. Let me point out that there's no healthcare involved in these Zoom calls, so none of this was our fault. I'm Peter Chernin. I'm your host for tonight. I am an English graduate of Berkeley. I make movies. I make television shows. I run a private equity company. But the thing that's most meaningful to me is I've been on the board of visitors at Cal for about 14, 15 years. And I've had the privilege of serving as the chair of the Board of Visitors for approximately the past 6 years. And I think there are few things in life that I care as deeply about as Berkeley, not only for its academic excellence, which is sort of a given, but I think it's that combination of academic excellence with access, with inclusion, with equity, with meritocracy, which I think makes it truly one of the unique places in the world today and something truly worthy of our support. I'm thrilled to welcome you all to this panel, and I think I can't think of a time when this has been more meaningful and more relevant. You know, the pandemic has revealed just how fragile we as human beings are, and yet at the same time, you know, the value of researching and protecting human life has never been more urgent. Health, medicine, discovery are at the cusp of a revolution, and we're really proud that Berkeley researchers are leading the way. Light the Way will support faculty and students in uncovering the molecular mechanisms of disease and building new medical research, devices, therapeutics, treatments, et cetera, for human health. I'm pleased and honored to introduce two faculty leaders in this field today. First, Jennifer Doudna, who is the Lee Kai-shing Chancellor's Chair in Biomedical and Health Sciences, and the brand new winner, I think about a month ago, of the 2020 Nobel Prize in Chemistry. Randy Schekman is Professor of Cell and Development Biology and winner of the 2013 Nobel Prize in Physiology or Medicine. And just think how rare it is for our university to have two Nobel Prize winners on the same subject and being able to participate. Each of them will speak for about 3 minutes, and then we'll open it up for questions before returning to the main event. So Jennifer, if we could kick it off with you.
Thank you, Peter. It's a great pleasure to be here with all of you and with my colleague, Randy Schekman. I couldn't be more excited to tell you about my experience at UC Berkeley. I came to Berkeley in 2002. I was recruited here from Yale, where I had started my faculty career. And I've always been a scientist who was interested in fundamental discoveries. I'm a big believer that our understanding of the world and, frankly, our technologies for manipulating our environment and our bodies often come from unexpected directions. And that's absolutely been my experience in my career. So when I came to Berkeley, I had the good fortune to meet many talented faculty members and students, including Jillian Banfield, a colleague of ours here at Berkeley in a different department, a different college, worked on something completely different from me. She was studying microbes in the environment, but our research intersected when we both got interested in the possibility that bacteria use an adaptive immune system to protect themselves against viruses. We started investigating how this might work, and I began working with a collaborator, Emmanuel Charpentier, and together we figured out that this system called CRISPR operates as a way that bacteria can find and destroy viruses using precise proteins that can be programmed to cut DNA. And by understanding that fundamental process, we realized that those proteins, those CRISPR proteins, could be harnessed as a technology for genome editing, a way that scientists could manipulate DNA and cells and organisms precisely to do things like understand the fundamental functions of genes, but also importantly to correct disease-causing mutations at the source. And so I began working more and more on genome editing. I started the Innovative Genomics Institute here at Berkeley and UCSF to take the CRISPR technology and build it into a fully sustainable and standard of care treatment for genetic disease that will ultimately be affordable and accessible to people everywhere that need this. It's an incredible thing to think about, and I can't imagine a better place to be working on such a goal than the University of California, Berkeley. And I would just add that over the years, I've had interactions with many students and postdoctoral scientists who are drawn to this great university of ours because of the opportunity to do world-class, cutting-edge research. So I'm a big believer in Cal and the value of public education.
Thank you, Peter, and good to share the stage, the virtual stage, with my colleague Jennifer. Let me start by saying how much I owe to the University of California for giving me the opportunity to live the life of a teacher and a scholar of biomedical science. I'm going to go back pretty far in my personal story. My journey began in 1966 when I rode my motorcycle the 30 miles from my family home in Orange County to the UCLA campus to begin my freshman year with an intended major in microbiology. I had inspiring teachers in chemistry, including the Cal-trained Nobel laureate Willard Libby, who invented carbon-14 radio dating. But even more important was the chance to do research beginning in my freshman year and extending through my 4 years, including a year in Edinburgh, Scotland, on a year abroad. And now, many years later, beginning my 45th year as a faculty member at Cal, I have the chance to reflect on the wonderful students, colleagues, and friends who made my life at Cal such a joy. Many of you will remember our dear former colleague and leader, Daniel Koshland Jr., who was the chair of the biochemistry department here when I was hired as an assistant professor in 1976. Dan led a major reorganization of the life sciences that produced a world-class department of molecular and cell biology, of which Jennifer and I are members. This department was also the home base for the work of our former colleagues and fellow laureates Elizabeth Blackburn and James Allison. Early in my career, Dan Koshland communicated my first publication on the work that led to my Nobel Prize to a journal that he, and many years later I, led as editor-in-chief, the journal called The Proceedings of the National Academy of Sciences. More recently, my friend and our MCB colleague, Robert Tejan, the former president of the Howard Hughes Medical Institute, encouraged me to take on a new challenge to create an international program to identify and support teams of investigators working on the growing threat of Parkinson's disease, an illness that took the life of my wife of 44 years. In a partnership with the Michael J. Fox Foundation, and with generous philanthropic support from the Sergey Brin Family Foundation, I've been asked to organize an effort to uncover the molecular and cellular basis of Parkinson's disease, the second most prevalent neurodegenerative disease, which afflicts around 1 million people in this country. Although there are treatments that diminish the severity of the symptoms of PD, there are no effective treatments that change the arc of this inevitably fatal illness. Our charge is to identify the origins and mechanism of disease progression so that more meaningful targets for therapeutic intervention may be developed. I'll be pleased to speak about this effort and more in our Q&A session now. Thanks.
Great. Well, thank you so much, Randy. And maybe we'll start off with the first question now. And Jennifer, we have a bunch of questions, all of them sort of on the same topic, which is, people are sort of asking, how do you think, is there any possible impact that CRISPR can have on COVID? How should we be thinking of, just talk about the relationship between CRISPR and COVID.
It's a great question. It's a bacterial immune system that fights viruses. So it seems like a natural for harnessing it in the face of this pandemic. And in fact, that's exactly what we're doing. So at the Innovative Genomics Institute at Berkeley, we started an effort a few months back to use CRISPR as a new kind of diagnostic for detecting infection with the coronavirus. And this has been a multi-lab effort. I like to think about it as the lab without walls. It's a big team that's working together to use engineering, chemistry, the CRISPR technology, and all of the incredible smart student resources that we have on our campus to put this together as a useful diagnostic. And we're hopeful that within the next couple of months, we will have a point of care diagnostic test that can be run on the Berkeley campus to provide surveillance testing for people who need it.
Great, thank you so much. Randy, let me ask you a question. You know, so much of your work has led to multiple new discoveries and industries, but what I'm curious about is over the course of your career, maybe you could talk a little bit about how scientific discovery is changing. Obviously, I assume in many ways it's been the same for decades, if not hundreds of years, but in other ways I assume just the nature of research and discovery is changing, and I assume Cal is at the forefront of that, and I think it would be fascinating to maybe hear you just talk about that a little bit.
Sure. Well, when I started 44 years ago, the techniques of analysis of cellular processes were based largely on very traditional approaches such as the use of genetics and the use of biochemistry. And my own works, for the most part, I was working on a simple organism called baker's yeast, and we were studying the process of how cells manage to produce molecules that are exported outside of cells, with no idea that it would have any practical advantage. And so, in the course of the first dozen or so years of our work, we discovered that yeast cells have the same process of manufacture and export of molecules as human cells. And at the time, it became possible to clone genes, to identify and isolate particular genes. And in a race that was conducted around the world and was finally achieved at Genentech, it became possible to clone the gene for human insulin. And the ambition then was to use that gene to try to manufacture a convenient source of human insulin, because for decades, people who were diabetics had to rely on pig pancreas insulin for their treatments. But with the advent of recombinant DNA and the ability to take a gene, even for a human protein, and engineer it into yeast, what we had discovered as the sort of evolutionary foundation of this process of protein export could be imported into yeast. And so a company that was started in part by our colleague Ed Penhote, called Chiron, was able to engineer the expression of human insulin in yeast. This is something that would have been a fantasy when I started in 1976. And now, as a result, one-third of the world's supply of insulin is made by expression in giant fermentation vats of yeast cells. That's just one small example of the developments in technology that feed on the basic science discoveries that we make in the laboratories here.
Well, thanks. That's fascinating. Jennifer, maybe I could ask you a question. You know, you've spoken, you know, really eloquently and movingly, particularly in light of the Nobel Prize, about possibly being an inspiration to girls in science and sort of the opportunity to get more girls involved in STEM. And I wonder if maybe you could just talk a little bit about how you view that opportunity and what some of the possibilities are and what kind of progress we're making.
Well, it's astounding to realize that this year's Nobel Prize in Chemistry, which is given to two women, is a first in the history of the Nobels to go to women. And I look forward to a day when that's not surprising. And also, I think it's very interesting that this prize in particular has inspired many students, especially girls, who have written to me in the last month to say that they feel excited about the future for them in science. They feel somehow validated by this prize, and it's very special to have the opportunity for me, certainly, to be encouraging girls as I was once encouraged as a girl to pursue my passion about science. So I'm very excited about this. I'm planning to use my Nobel money to support access for underrepresented students in the STEM fields, a program that has been started here at Cal and is already attracting some extraordinarily talented students from around the world. And this is something that I think Cal does extremely well, is to make education and research available to everybody.
I'd love you guys to talk about sort of the role of your students, your graduate students particularly, but even some of your undergraduates, and the sort of research you've done and what it means to be at an institution like Berkeley, what it means to have such a large student body and such a diverse student body. And I'd love, I think it'd be fascinating to hear sort of what the interaction and what the value of that is from a student perspective.
Jennifer, go ahead.
Okay, well, I can't say enough good things about the Berkeley student body. We have incredible people here that come from all over the world with an interest in learning and education. I think one of Berkeley's real gems are our undergraduate students. Many of them come here because they want to do research at a top research university, and they are eager to get into the laboratory and make new discoveries. We've had many examples of students that have done fundamental work in the lab. They're fearless. They take on creative, exciting projects. They bring their own creativity to those projects, and they push them in new directions. CRISPR is no exception. We had an extraordinary summer undergraduate who came to the lab and was part of the team that did the original work in our collaboration with Emmanuel Charpentier. And over the last decade at least, since we did that original work on CRISPR, I've had a whole string of incredibly talented students that have done research on all kinds of aspects having to do with the fundamental science and the application of CRISPR. It's extraordinary to work with them, and it's a real honor.
Randy, you want to take a quick shot, and then I think we're going to have to wrap, but if you could. You just talk quickly.
Well, let me tell you one little story about my very first undergraduate research student. This young woman had a troubled background. She had to drop out of high school. She had two children and a very brief family life. She then realized how smart she was. She got a GED degree. She went to Foothill Junior College and was admitted to Cal. She came to my lab as a junior student, and she worked so hard that she was able to publish her work. She used to use her welfare money to pay for babysitters so that she could come to the lab. She went on to a very successful career. She's elected to the National Academy of Sciences. She was on the council of the National Academy. She's one of six of my former students who've become members of the National Academy of Sciences. This is what Cal does for everyone. It is the engine of social mobility in this country.